Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Institute of World Politics. Before we get started this afternoon, just a couple of very brief housekeeping matters. If you wouldn't mind making sure that all of your devices are turned to silent mode, we'd appreciate that. Second, this event is being recorded. So during the Q&A portion, we request that prior to stating your question, you give us your name and affiliation. It just helps keep the environment collegial and help us get to know everyone. We are the Institute of World Politics. If this is your first time visiting us, we are a graduate school of national security and international affairs. We're dedicated to teaching all of the instruments of statecraft in a coherent, strategically integrated fashion. And we have three full academic master's degree programs, two professional MAs, and a number of certificate programs as well. We're all gathered here this afternoon for Dr. Joseph J. Collins of the National Defense University, speaking on his new book, Lessons Encountered, Learning from the Long War. Dr. Collins is the director of the Center for Complex Operations at NDU. Prior to that, Dr. Collins spent a decade at the National War College teaching national security strategy. He was also Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Stability Operations, the senior Department of Defense civilian official for peacekeeping, humanitarian assistance, and stabilization and reconstruction operations. He's formerly a senior fellow of the Center for Strategic and International Studies. Prior to all of that, he spent a 28-year career in the United States Army in infantry and armor, as well as numerous staff positions, including on the Army staff and in the Office of the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. He also taught at West Point. His PhD is in political science from Columbia University, and he's also the author of Understanding the War in Afghanistan in 2011, which I believe was also from National Defense University Press. And he is a contributing editor to Armed Forces Journal. Without further ado, Dr. Joseph Collins. Thank you very much.
I have to correct our the good professor. I have to say I was a contributing editor to the Armed Forces Journal. About 2 years after I started that, they went belly up. So, but boy, was that was a lot of fun. This project started for the Institute for National Strategic Studies at the National Defense University in a rather strange way. It came down as a directed set of questions from the chairman. He didn't really sort of decide what it was we were going to do. We defied him. We told him the title, Lessons Encountered, and he said, oh, that's a loser. But we stuck with it, and our folks kind of grew on them, because the more we studied what happened in Iraq and Afghanistan, and we only studied what happened in Iraq and Afghanistan, we wanted also to do the war against al-Qaeda, but the chairman warned us off of that. And we also wanted to do, at the very least, one more contingency, and that was the operations that we conducted in the Philippines. We were told, listen, when you get a mission, you get a mission. Shut up and do what you're told. Lessons Encountered came in. It was, of course, an expression made famous by the Brits, but it seemed more and more right for us, because most of the lessons that we learned from Iraq and Afghanistan have no claim to novelty. They're actually new, and not new, we're encountering them perhaps in many cases because other people failed to learn them. So we abandoned lessons learned in favor of lessons encountered. We have, by the way, a rollout of our book at the National Defense University, 17 November. And if you want to come over to the university, we will not only have a reception afterwards, we also will be giving out copies of the book. We hope to have it all for that. Okay, slide please. Two key questions came from the chairman. What were the cost benefits of the campaigns in Iraq and Afghanistan. It's part of what we call the Long War. Again, General Dempsey said he didn't like the term Long War. It was passé. Well, we're bringing it back again because we couldn't find anything better. What were the cost benefits of the war in Iraq? And then what were the strategic lessons? Somebody asked General Dempsey, well, what do you mean, sir, by strategic? And he said, perhaps with a bit of whimsy, he said, chairman of the Joint Chiefs and above, which, you know, sort of puts us into what they called at Fort Benning echelons above reality. But in any case, you know, this is a Paul Mill book. There's barely a good-sized battle in this book. I think the two battles of Fallujah might have gotten three lines between them. The audience, we were told, was the senior-most officers, and we said, well, we can't write a book only for four-star generals, because that will mean nobody will read it. But we said, we're going to also write for their staffs, and also JPME students, who we like to think of as the leaders of the future. All right, the next to last bullet there, learning from history is learning by analogy, and strategic lessons are of that ilk, and that's very, very difficult. And we talk a lot in the introduction about the problems of learning from history. If you are a student of this particular sub-subject, you'll find that there are some people who fail to learn from history. And sometimes they're ignorant and sometimes they're misdirected. But most people try very hard to learn from history. And the sad fact of the matter is a lot of people get it wrong. And we picked on the French in the introduction to talk about, you know, armies that tried extremely hard to learn the lessons of wars and failed three times in a row, as a matter of fact. Learning in large, complex organizations is different than learning as a person. If you touch a hot stove and you burn yourself, that you're going to carry that with you for a long time. You know, if you drop your M16 into the sand, it's going to get filled up with dirt, and you're going to learn that lesson. And a person is an individual lesson is fairly easy to learn and to internalize, particularly the burnt fingers from the stove. But when you're talking about learning in large and complex operations, you're not just talking about figuring out what happened. You're also trying to, you know, debate complex lessons and come to conclusions, and those conclusions ultimately have to be packaged and then institutionalized. You know, if you want to learn the lessons of Afghanistan, Iraq, or Vietnam, you have to have a way of inculcating them into the officer and NCO cadres that come down the pike. You have to institutionalize them, and that's difficult. Next slide, please. It's pretty much what the whole book looks like. Chapter one is Iraq and Afghanistan from the immediate years before that up until the beginning of the surge in both countries. Frank Hoffman and Alex Crowther wrote the next chapter, which has to do with the concept of assessing and adapting. And they actually used as their cases the surges. So now you've gone from 2001 all the way up to 2012. The third and longest chapter in the book is a rehash of decision making and implementation from our resident systems theorist, Chris Lamb. Chapter four was a bit controversial because the people who wanted us to do this and were getting progress reports kept saying, you know, I don't know about that. Raising and mentoring security forces, it's just not all that strategic. And we would have to point out to them time after time, listen, in both Iraq and Afghanistan, that was the exit strategy. We were going to raise and train an army and a police force. And if that activity becomes the core of your exit strategy in those cases, well, you better figure out, you better check up to see how well you did on that. Then the many legal issues in Chapter 5 was done by Nick Rostow and Harvey Rishikoff. And then finally, reflections on lessons encountered, which are done by both of the editors, myself and Rich Hooker. There is a human and financial costs annex in our book, and if there's anything that makes a headline, it's probably going to be something that's in there, because we set out to sort of enumerate the human and financial costs. And by the way, it's kind of overwhelming, and we'll come back to that. Okay, and then we have timelines for both the conflicts. Next slide, please. All right, these are the areas in which we drew major lessons, and I will take them one by one. But first, let me talk about decision making. We looked in particular, we looked very closely at three major cases, the first being the invasion of Iraq, the Iraq surge, and the Afghan surge. And all of them were problematical to one degree or another. In the invasion of Iraq, we had the influence of Donald Rumsfeld and the development of what was, in effect, a best case plan for a very difficult case situation. In the Iraq surge, I think we had a wonderful case where the president engaged in what I'll call, any sense that I'm exaggerating, in really creative decision making. But unfortunately, if you're a senior officer, as you look at the Iraq surge, which actually worked and worked very well, and I consider the surge, and we consider the surge, to be much more than just the sending of 30 or 40,000 troops. It was the awakening. It was a surge. It was the surge in the development of the Iraqi armed forces and whatever. And so it was a lot of different things. But in any case, the surge worked wonderfully. But if you are looking at civil military reactions, action inside of decision making, you have to realize that in the Iraq surge, the president, in effect, overruled every four-star general who had a say in the decision. Now, the military was sort of brought back on board, but the officers who were, in command at that time, all had a different idea. And then, of course, the Afghan surge, lots of problems there between the military and the new Obama administration. And I think we have in some ways a flawed decision at the end of that, but one which left a lot of hurt feelings on both the civil and military sides of the issue. Unity of effort and unity of command, just to give you a little preview there, unity of effort with the United States entire federal government, it's really hard. It's almost impossible. Unity of effort. But unity of command, you would think, we know how to do that. You build a squad, and then you have the platoon, and then your company, and you have one guy who's the gal or is the commanding officer, and we know how to do this unity of command thing. Wrong. We do not. And this lash up, both in Iraq and Afghanistan, had all of the similar problems of the war in Vietnam. Intelligence and understanding the operational environment. Two separate problems that are sort of lumped together. understanding the operational environment may not be an intelligence problem, but then if that's the case, we need to figure out whose problem it is primarily to help the forces on the ground. And then we had some observations about the character of contemporary conflict and a few on security force assistance. So this tells you what we encountered. Here's how we went about finding it. This was what I call our guiding spirit. Abraham Lincoln had the same problem, and he said, hey, human nature won't change. And the people in the future are going to be as weak and as strong, as silly and as wise, and as bad and as good. And then he said, let us therefore study the incidents in this war as a philosophy to learn wisdom from, and none of them as wrongs to be avenged. It was pretty good. It was actually an off-the-cuff answer to a question at an event that had nothing to do with this particular topic. But as we went through, we decided that we were not the place to sort of go into sort of an ad hominem investigation or indictment or whatever. We stuck to the policy and we treated the people with as much dignity as we could afford to give them. Next slide, please. Okay, the various issue areas. And for you folks in the back, there are some seats here in the front. These next five or six slides are reading tests, vision, testing your visual acuity. Civilians and military people in decision making, the first bullet, it's a fascinating study. The military have a rather linear, rather rigid process, which is taught to them from the junior officer ranks all the way up through the staff college and the war college. And every question of what do we do now starts with the issue of what are our objectives. And what we found, looking at all of these cases involved in these two campaigns, was that civilians, both Republican civilians and Democrat civilians, they don't do it that way. In fact, the military works from objectives downward, and the civilians seem to want to work from options back toward objectives. It's a fascinating process, and both sides need to do better at understanding how the other one works. The second bullet, the unequal dialogue, we saw here an anomalous situation. In most cases, war plans and the details of war plans are worked out between the chairman of the Joint Chiefs and the combatant commanders, and then they are brought pretty much on a platter to the chairman, to the Secretary of Defense, and to the president. In this one here, we had a Secretary of Defense who said, I am the supervisor of the combatant commanders. And when we're talking about war planning, I want to be in on the case when it's a blank sheet of paper. And so the secretary worked his magic and had his preference. And our message to military people here is civil-military relations are, in Elliot Cohen's words, an unequal dialogue. And this is something that military people have to adjust to, because where the dividing line between military skills and professionalism and the prerogatives of the secretary, where that line is drawn, is that's all in the hands of the secretary. That's within his power. And you have to be able to deal with both types. Of course, you know, maybe the lesson for civilians here is that, you know, you ought to see where Mr. Rumsfeld drew the line and then draw it someplace else, because it didn't work out all that well. Okay. Or maybe it did. Don't take my interpretation of events or any of these as possible. I fought very hard, by the way, in the beginning of this effort when we had we had a conversation every 10 days about what should the title of the book be. And my first recommendation was First Cut. And I said, we are way out in front of the pack in doing this, and 100 books are going to come behind us, so we should be called First Cut. And they said, no, that sounds like, you know, it was a slapdash effort and this, that, and the other thing. But, my fondest hope here is that one day this book will be eclipsed by people who read it, who say, oh my God, those guys did only half a job. I could do so much better. Okay, your third bullet there. This is a very genteel way of saying that in the U.S. military, we grow great warriors, great tacticians, pretty good masters of the operational art. And then in terms of the higher levels of military strategy and national security strategy, the pool of great practitioners is pretty thin. We listed some of the skills there that a lot of our generals don't have. And you know, it's funny, I spent a good part of my career, my dad, who recently passed away, he said, when I would tell him what I was doing, he said, well, you know, in World War II, you know, we called guys who did what you did, he said, we would call them the dog robbers, because they would even rob the dogs if it was necessary. And but I worked for a chairman and an undersecretary and a secretary of defense and a chairman of the Joint Chiefs. And when they rise to that level, one thing you frequently hear from them in the beginning is that for the big jobs around them, you know, G357 on the Army staff, J5, J3 on the Joint Staff, they say, hey, you know, the bench is very thin. And they feel sort of alone. And they get great people and great warriors and great corps commanders and great fleet commanders come up, and strategy has never been their game. And now they are sitting at the council tables with all of the great ones. Okay. Next slide, please. Still on the subject of decision making, and this is a couple of things here represent things that General Dempsey told us. By the way, General Dempsey's interview for this book is in JFQ, Joint Force Quarterly, number 78, and that's available on the NDU Press website. It's a terrific interview. It's also his last interview, and it's very frank. We had the deputy J5 there with us, and we talked for almost 3 hours. And he came away, the deputy J5 shook his head, and he said, you know, I've been with this guy every day for 3 years, and I heard things in this room I've never heard him say out loud. So it's a great interview. Similarly, Steve Hadley reflected a lot on national security decision making and the Iraq War. That's in PRISM, the journal PRISM, volume 5.3, and that's available on the Center for Complex Operations website, which if you just Google Center for Complex Operations, it will come up. But in any case, national decision making, it's all about trust. And in the military, trust comes from people knowing each other over the years. Trust also comes from when you go onto a battle staff, everybody has their job. They have a charter. When an issue comes up, and who's going to write the intelligence estimate? There's never a question as to who's going to carry that out. The intelligence officer is going to carry that out. And you know, it's very cut and dried sort of division of labor. And you don't always have that between cabinet agencies. And General Dempsey said one of the most important things to do is to build trust on these teams. By the way, Stan McChrystal said, and it didn't make it fully into the book, so I'll just tell you what he said. He said, we spend millions of dollars, and I'm paraphrasing, of course. He said, we spend millions of dollars making every infantry squad into a finely trained team. And he said, the most important national security outfit in the world are the Principals Committee and the Deputies Committee. And these people meet day after day, and they're strangers. Nobody spends a penny to make them into a team. And his recommendations, I loved his recommendations. His recommendations were two, was that number one, they should frequently drink beer together. And number two was that they should go white water rafting together. In any case, I thought, you know, what a unique take on all of this. The deputies committee as a team of strangers. And, you know, if you're the president and you're really thinking about that, it's just a fascinating thought, new, outside the box. And if you want to learn more about that, General McChrystal has a little outfit down in Alexandria, and he'll write you a contract. Okay, senior military planners. Political and military objectives. These are very difficult in cases like Iraq and Afghanistan, and we have to spend a lot of time thinking about connecting the military to the political. Sad to say, we're not very good about that. Post-conflict planning was inadequate for Iraq, non-existent for Afghanistan, and we played a pickup game thereafter. Policy and strategy, General Dempsey reminded us, are highly sensitive to budget, election, and news cycles. And he said, you would think that's a blinding flash of the obvious. He said, but a lot of military people don't get it. They're enmeshed in their daily activities 24/7. 365 days out of the year, and what they're finding is, oh my God, you know, I come to Washington and, you know, the old team, I knew all those guys very well. Then a new team of guys comes in and there's no adjustments made in the policy, in the strategy, in the recommendations, in the building of trust between people, because the military, it continues on, and one man or woman falls down and another man or woman takes their place, and again, they have all of these standing operating procedures that keep them all on the same sheet of music, and all of the commanders have gone to the same schools. They've gone to the basic course, the advanced course, they've gone to, and they have different names, of course, in different services. Then they've gone to the staff college, and then they've gone to war college, and they've all been stewing in the same soup for decades, literally. And then a new group of civilians come in, and the old-time retired military national security experts are replaced by people who were, in effect, excellent people on the presidential campaign. And you leave, Steve Hadley and J.D. Crouch. J.D. Crouch is, in effect, replaced by Ben Rhodes, who before the Obama campaign was an unemployed reporter, journalist. Now, I have nothing against him or anybody else. I'm just trying to emphasize that the election cycle has a tremendous impact on decision making, for better or worse. New teams can be better than old teams. There's nothing that says that that can't be true. But military people, unfortunately, don't always get that. And one of our big reference points here was the first year of the Obama administration and our attempts by the military to change the game, if you will, in Afghanistan. Okay, next slide, please. Unity of command, unity of effort, whole of government efforts. I'm great preacher in the church of whole of government, but I think I've been excommunicated because it's just so hard to believe in it. In any case, the United States was unable to knit together its vast interagency capabilities for two reasons. First, many of those bureaucracies, and state and AID come to mind here, have too few people and too few resources. My favorite factoid, 1949, the budget of the Department of State was 49% of the Department of Defense's budget, 49%. Today, if you add everything in to include security assistance, you might be able to get to 10%. And so that just sort of gives you the relative strengths there. I'm not arguing that the State Department, actually I am. I'm arguing that if, people are always talking about the over-militarization of U.S. foreign policy. It's inevitable. When you have a 90-10 distribution of assets, it's inevitable. It's inevitable. You know, it's funny, there was this I can't remember who said it first, but a lot of people said there are, and even more people quoted it, that there are more people in marching bands in the armed forces than there are in the Department of State. And one year at the National War College, after three of our speakers mentioned something like that, the students got a big kettle and they put a sign over it, and they were the objective of their fundraising was to get the State Department a band. But in any case, so short on capabilities. The second problem of whole of government efforts is weak implementation. And maybe there's a third one which follows on closely to weak implementation that basically says, there are people who are actively working against this. Congressional authorities are very, very tough, and they're very, very precise, and they become rice bowls. They become rice bowls on Capitol Hill. And if we had a situation like Afghanistan or Iraq tomorrow in a completely different place, we would have some of the same problems we had bureaucratically and authorities-wise as we had in Iraq and Afghanistan. Now, that's not to say that we ought to take all of these authorities and give them to the Department of Defense, because there are real holes in the skill and knowledge of people in the Department of Defense, and that's simply because these issues have always been elsewhere. But there are things that don't make sense. USAID, which is programmatic, it gets things done on the ground, it digs wells, it digs hospitals. They're not allowed to be engaged in police training. Well, there was some incident in the 60s, and AID basically has their attitude toward police training is, don't blame us, we're not allowed. So, and then it's put on the State Department proper, who doesn't have the people, doesn't have the programmers and whatever, so it becomes a contractual operation, which doesn't always work right. Big problem here for me, unity of command. I just want to read you just a little tiny section out of the book. Unity of command is a time-proven American tradition that has been applied to great effect in the Civil War, World War I, and World War II. This principle, however, seems to have been bypassed in the development of disjointed command and control structures in Iraq and Afghanistan. Indeed, General David Petraeus noted that we did not get the strategy and command and control architecture right in Afghanistan until 2010. Actually, it's not quite true. It was 2012, because there's sort of a codicil to this having to do with unifying the various types of Special Operations Command. That doesn't come around until 2012. Creating unity of command within large coalitions will remain a high point of military art, and it's a task that we did not do well in here. Did better in Iraq than we did in Afghanistan. Okay, the final bullet here talks about the importance of assessment here. There were some good work done in the later part of the Bush administration, and interestingly enough, some of the same people who did great work in the Bush administration were held up by people, scholars and practitioners, at the end of the Obama administration for being not doing a good job. So the techniques and people and procedures that worked in the Bush administration were much less successful in the Obama administration. There are mysteries here. And part of this is wrapped up in various personalities. And a part of it has to do with sort of freedom of action, too. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, intelligence. I want to read you the intelligence. I don't want to call it a finding. That sounds too serious. But our observation: neither national nor military intelligence in Iraq and Afghanistan was a success in supporting decision makers. Intelligence on Afghanistan itself was scant and not actionable in the beginning. In Iraq, pre-war intelligence was wrong about weapons of mass destruction, the Iraqi police, and the state of the Iraqi infrastructure. U.S. forces had little information on tribal dynamics and the potential role of Iran. In both wars, U.S. intelligence failed in telling battle space owners about the people whom they were protecting. The effect of these shortcomings was grave. Now, it goes on to say that the biggest advances in intelligence came in supporting the warfighter at the tactical level, and particularly between special operations forces and all-source intelligence. In 2008, General Dempsey was the, by that time, acting CENTCOM commander. He visited an outpost, a special forces outpost on the border with Pakistan, commanded by a captain. And it was his opinion that this captain had more access to better intelligence in 2008 than he had as a two-star general in Baghdad in 2003. We took him at his word on that. Okay. And then, of course, the problem of understanding the environment. By the way, the final bullet there, in various words, was also a finding of the Joint Center for Operational and Coalition Operational Analysis part of J7. They did a study on the operational lessons. Also, a RAND study done recently by Linda Robinson and company had basically the same finding as the third bullet. I remember, too, since he died recently, Stanley Hoffman from Harvard said that he could sum up the lessons of Vietnam in one phrase. He said it was neglect of local circumstances, and it just seems to me that we're still on that wheel. Two problems: our commanders didn't know the local area or people, and this was a war which was about protecting the people. The Band-Aid solutions, AFPAC hands and the terrain teams, too little, too late for the most part. Also, when you take big units and you put them in the field and then you try and bolt on foreign parts to those units, it generally does not work. There were some human terrain teams that were outstanding. There were some AFPAC hands that performed marvelously. There were some FAOs in the field who performed extraordinarily. But generally speaking, it wasn't enough. The thing that sort of bothers me the most about this particular bullet is there's no solution, there's no sense that a solution's in the works. Because the intelligence agencies, as Steve Hadley said, he said the intelligence agencies don't believe it's intelligence unless they stole it. Which I think is kind of cute. But I mean, they are oriented on studying the threat and classified information. There's no sense in general among the intelligence bureaucracy that helping commanders in irregular warfare understand the people who are friendly or potentially friendly is their mission. So there's no fix in. There are some people, by the way, who it's kind of an insurgent movement, if you will, at DIA who's working this. And there are lots of people on the joint doctrine side who are working on new joint doctrine for human aspects of military operations. That's the latest term. The term du jour is HAMO, human aspects of military operations. And so, HAMO. Next slide, please. We couldn't resist putting on our, Thucydides and Clausewitz hat to talk about the character of contemporary conflict. And the first thing that occurred to us is in conventional warfare or logistics, the United States has no parallel, maybe never has had any peer, particularly in logistics. You know, in the middle of this war in Afghanistan, the Pakistanis got angry at us after the bin Laden raid and all of that. And they closed down the line of communication over which 80% of our materiel came into theater. And nobody noticed inside Afghanistan. There was never a Burger King in Afghanistan that went without buns or pickles or all beef patties. The logisticians redid overnight almost the logistical lines of communication, and they developed what's called the Northern Route. And if you took a map of Eurasia, the Northern Route looks like a bowl of spaghetti thrown onto that map. It was probably a logistical feat, the equivalent of the Berlin airlift, and nobody noticed. Because we do that stuff all the time. And I remember my old professor, William T.R. Fox, the man who invented the word superpower, he used to say that superpower was great power plus great mobility of power, and we still have it, for what it's worth. Tactically, excellent. Operationally, excellent. But insensitive to the needs of the post-conflict environment, and not well prepared for insurgency, and in truth not well prepared for insurgency because lessons encountered in Vietnam and other places were not institutionalized in the armed forces. On the other hand, I would say that this is a learning military you have. And they were very adaptable, and they adapted both on an individual level and after 2006 as an armed forces to the problem of insurgency. We can talk more about that, and there have been great debates about the coin denisters and the cointras and all that. And by the way, there's almost none of that in the book because we couldn't bear to do it. Second one there, some controversy on this one too. A prudent great power should avoid being a third party in a large-scale counterinsurgency effort. Foreign expeditionary forces in another country's insurgency have almost always failed. We noted two exceptions. the U.S. and the Philippines, 1899 to 02, and the British in Malaya, 1950 to 1962. But in both of those cases, two conditions pertained. Number one, the Foreign Expeditionary Force was also the de facto government of the country. Didn't have to work through a weak actor government. And secondly, neither the Philippine insurrectos or the Malayan guerrillas had significant outside help or sanctuaries in other countries. Next slide, please. We now are sort of getting into the smaller lessons, still important though. Complex legal issues need to be sorted out ahead of time. In our conversation with him, General Dempsey said, it was one of the few times he almost jumped out of his chair. He said, detention issues, it really made him angry. He said, but you know, when you think about it, he said, the last time the United States Army did detention on a large scale was in the Korean War. And even then, a lot of that mission was being done by the South Koreans. So, he said, you gotta work on that. Interestingly enough, there were aspects of the U.S. Army military police in the U.S. Army Reserve that were not sort of put to good use. There are a couple of EPW, Enemy Prisoner of War Brigades in the U.S. Army Reserve, and they were never used as such. Acquisition system. We gave it the gentleman's B minus, and that was because ultimately it came up with what was needed, but not until having exhausted all other possibilities. And the Secretary of Defense, particularly Secretary Gates, you know, broke both of his hands beating on the logistics and acquisitions people to do their job. Strategic communications, weak point. Thank you for the dramatic music. Strategic communications was a weak point in our performance in Washington in the field. Part of that was unavoidable. When bad stuff happens, you really can't. You can only put lipstick on a pig in the movies. You know, everybody knows that Abu Ghraib was a travesty, and there was just no getting around it. And then all of the problems with the CIA, the black sites, and all of that, a black eye that was going to stay black for quite some time. But I find it ironic that, you know, the country that sort of, invented so much of modern communications, and the country that has Hollywood, and the country that has Madison Avenue, in many cases lost out to people who were doing their graphics in a cave. So, I don't know how you get better. And I hope you're noticing here that we called out a lot of mistakes for which we do not have recommendations. Because, and boy, we had some knockout, drag-out fights because old military men, they want to say, here's the problem, and here's how you fix it, okay? And we left the chairman and the readers of our book with a whole basket full of problems for which we did not propose solutions. We thought it was best to do that, and it still bothers me to this day that we didn't have a chapter on here's 87 things you can do right now and next week to fix it, because that's a mentality. But a lot of these things need great discussion. And we're on to the next one now, security force assistance. I'll just let you read that for a second. This is one of the toughest chapters in our book, and I would give our training of the National Security Forces in Iraq and Afghanistan a B, and T.X. Hammes, who wrote this chapter, is much more critical than I was. We need to learn how to do this better. And I'll tell you one thing, we're not focused on this in a real way. When we're getting ready to retrain Iraqis or to train up people in another country, if it's a small-scale thing, we deploy special forces, and generally that works out well. But if you're building somebody's army, the special forces A-team is not the building block. Okay, you need some kind of military assistance group. Now, the Army solution to that is, I'm going to give you an infantry brigade. And today they're an infantry brigade, and poof, tomorrow they're going to be a security assistance brigade. And they're going to leave some of their trucks home and a lot of their people, and they're going to, you know, fall in the unit and train it. And that's not the solution. Because you'll end up, first off, you're going to have to bolt on to that unit a lot of things that don't come with it. And we've already discussed that problem of bolting things on. Okay? Doesn't necessarily work very well. And I personally, and again, we didn't say this in the book, but I personally think we really need some kind of combination of these missions being done by military assistance groups, and the smaller ones, the more rapid ones, the more conflict-oriented ones right away, by special forces troops. The notion of sending, you know, the 1st Brigade of the 82nd Airborne Division, sorry, it's not trained and equipped mentally or physically to do that. But in any case, you can do that. And what you'll get is training American style. And you don't want training American style. You want to train the locals for the local conditions with an appreciation for the local culture. People say, hey, too big a mission, you know? And I have a good friend of mine in my office who basically says, now listen, he says, I was in Grenada. I was in Somalia. I was in Bosnia. He was actually in Bosnia twice before the Dayton Accords and then after. He was battalion commander in Kosovo. He was brigade commander in Iraq. He was a division chief in Afghanistan. He said, now tell me, which one of those languages and cultures did you want me to know? And that's the opposite side of my argument. And you know, the people in the troop world say, listen, I mean, 2 tours in Iraq, 2 tours in Afghanistan, Bosnia, and, you know, I can remember back in Bosnia when we were banging on people to learn Serbo-Croatian. Where are they now? You know, they're in Kurdistan, you know? Okay, so I'm, again, don't know the solution. Third bullet there, transactional and conditional. Again, in the Joint Force Quarterly, number 78, read what General Dempsey has to say about this. General Dempsey said, was, of course, the major trainer of the Iraqi army the first time around, and he said, if I had to do this all over again, he said, everything we did with Iraq or Afghanistan would be transactional and conditional. And we would come in and we would say, we're going to do this for you, and this is what you're going to do for us. And if you don't, we are going to do this. And if you do it again, then we're going to have to renegotiate the whole enterprise. Now, The counter that to that, of course, is, you know, how do you build trust? Somehow it would emerge, I hope, in all of that. So, final bullet, improving our ability to teach others to defeat an insurgency or terrorist is likely to be the key to future U.S. participation in irregular conflicts. You don't want to get serious about that. You're not going to be serious about the security environment. And the security environment exists. It's out there. It determines what is going to come up on your plate. And you can, if you are a great power, say, we're not doing that. We're going to do this, but we're not going to do that. We're not going to do jungles, but we'll do deserts. We're going to do conventional war. We're not going to do unconventional war. You can say that. You can try and get away with it, but the record of the past few decades suggests that America is just like everybody else, and that you're going to react to what the security environment serves up to you one way or the other. Okay, next slide. I'm getting down to the end of this, and I'm sorry I'm going on. Cost of war. Decisions have consequences. And I just want to just sort of go down some of these with you so that my shorthand is understandable. And again, we have an annex in the book about this. 6,800 U.S. dead, 1,200 coalition dead, 52,000 U.S. wounded. By the way, further down there, 3,212 contractor personnel dead. Now, those are people working for U.S. contractors, not necessarily U.S. personnel. For the most part, probably the vast majority foreigners. But they get reported to the Department of Labor, by the way, not to the Veterans Administration or to the Department of Defense. Okay. By the way, in addition to that, 30,000 contractors injured on the job. Many of them minor, but still. And then on and on. PTSD and TBI, we've got a few paragraphs, but I'm not sure we've gotten to the bottom of that. 25 to 35,000 local security forces dead in Afghanistan and Iraq, and up to 190,000 local civilians dead in Afghanistan and Iraq. So what I'm trying to tell you is about 250,000 people died in Iraq and Afghanistan on our watch. About 250,000. It's a lot of people. You know, we are rightly transfixed on our own 6,800 dead, but there's 225,000 other people in the ground out there too. Okay, 246 journalists, 390 NGOs. Cost, the long war, the vast majority of which is the war for Iraq and Afghanistan, cost $1.6 trillion direct. That's a Congressional Research Service number going up all the way to mid-2015 with some estimates for FY15. No matter what methodology you use, whether you use direct cost, expanded cost, whatever, the long war is the second most expensive war in American history. It has surpassed Vietnam. You use then-year dollars, constant dollars, we tried three or four different ways to mix up that formulation, but the truth of the matter is the 14 years that we have been at war is now more expensive than Vietnam War, and more expensive than World War I, but not as expensive as World War II in constant dollars. Now, sad part about that is a lot of that money was put on the national credit card. Most wars, you have a war tax or war bonds or something like that. And those things, unfortunately, we don't have. So a gift that keep on giving, so to speak. And the next slide, please. And the last slide. This is the ultimate lesson. Okay, it's from Churchill in 1930. Okay, the statesman who yields to war fever must realize that once the signal is given, he is no longer the master of policy, but the slave of unforeseeable and uncontrollable events. Antiquated war offices, weak, incompetent, or arrogant commanders, untrustworthy allies, etc., all take their seats at the council board on the morrow of a declaration of war. And something to think about. I'm going to stop there, and you can turn off the slides, and we'll have Q&A. If I haven't exhausted all the time. Have I exhausted? How are we on time? I'll stay as long as you keep asking questions. I'm a believer in smart power. I don't think we've accomplished it.
Right.
I think if you look today, you know, in some ways, Al-Qaeda is less than it was in 2001. I think we're very much safer here at home, primarily because of the great work done on Homeland Security. But I think if you look overseas, you know, Al-Qaeda and other movements, even worse, have metastasized. And they exist in a number of different countries that are more. So from that standpoint, our smart power hasn't made a lot of things work. We're still very much actively in combat, usually working through our friends and allies. We're trying to keep boots off the ground, but that's very, very difficult. Because particularly, so, you know, when you are in the business of bombing small tactical kinds of targets on the ground, you need people out there who know what they're doing in terms of calling for fires, and you need Air Force and Green Beret people up front. And up until now, we haven't sort of crossed that bridge. I'd love to give more things to do to the State Department, but we're not in a situation here really where big parts of it, you know, can sort of, you know, become the subject of all of that.
Going off of what you've spent this time researching, don't you think the real issue is the institutional structure in the United States? The National Security Council, for instance, was broken when the Bush administration took over. You had the vice president, SecDef, and running a lot of the processes, which caused a lot of issues. There was conflicts of information that occurred, and then kind of were fought in public.
Sure.
And then with Obama, he took over and he expanded the NSC Council, the National Security Council, to I think like 390 people. It's unwieldy. It seems to be going operational at times, like it did under Nixon and then other
uh-huh.
times. So don't you think, though, not to mention the fact that the entire kind of DOD and all these systems were created in 1947 to fight the Soviets.
Right.
And we're fighting now an enemy that is very much on, look, I hear the long war, and I go, these are Cold Warriors talking. With all due respect, these are Cold Warriors talking.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if this is... I don't know.
Me too. Yeah.
I don't know if this is really applicable. Is it really the long war? Or is this Cold War institutions trying to find justification?
Well, I think the long war exists for one reason in particular. A group called Al Qaeda declared war in the United States in the mid 1990s, and then when we didn't react and get all in a huff, they blew up a couple of our embassies, and then when we did very little about that, they, you know, took out one of our warships, and then
because of our institutions, we were not recognizing it as a.
Well,
as a,
yeah, and part of it had to do also with the shift from the Clinton to the Bush administration. I was in the Bush administration, and I want to tell you, when in the beginning of the Bush administration, there were two people who got Al Qaeda, and nobody listened to them: George Tenet and Richard Clark. Everybody else in the administration, and I know this from having long conversations with people, when you said terrorism to them, what they heard was state sponsor. The notion that Al Qaeda was a major actor unto itself was it was not the dominant thought, which is why it takes until August to get a good National Security Council meeting on the subject of Al Qaeda. And in spite of the fact that there had been some very scary presidential daily briefs up to that point in time and shortly thereafter, there wasn't anything that anybody could see to do. Okay, because you know, it was really, as they, you know, Roberta Wallstetter, it was a failure of imagination, really, and then an overreaction. You know, a tremendous overreaction. Condi Rice said, we came to work and every day was September 10th. And we were obsessed with avoiding another, we were obsessed with avoiding another 911. And the president said in the State of the Union message in January of 2002, he said, the thing that scares me the most is the union between weapons of mass destruction and terrorism. And anybody who looked like somehow they could evolve or get twisted into WMD and terrorism all of a sudden became a special target. And of course, this sort of, you know, there was already sort of a very nasty sense of Iraq as unfinished business in the Bush administration. And it just sort of took off. You talked about the National Security Council structures. Chapter 3 of our book and chapter 1 of our book have sort of almost a subterranean argument going on about the role of people and the role of personalities and the role of assumptions versus the structures. The third chapter of our book, it basically says, hey, we need wholesale reform. And to that I say, I'd love to see things work better, but not if it means 400 people in the National Security Council staff. I'd love to see the next president pare it back to about 100 and then build it or tear it back further from there on. Because once you do that, you force a lot of this work back onto the bureaucracy. And instead of the NSC advisor and his or her minions writing the papers for the meetings, State Department gets the mission. You write the paper for this meeting. DOD, you write the paper for that meeting. They write the paper, they staff it as best they can, and then they bring it in and they fight it out in the PCC. They rewrite the paper, and then they fight it out again in the DC. I you know, that's slow, but it can work. Yeah, I think so, but it's hard to say what it is, because this is really the personal staff of the president. This is the executive office of the president, and you gotta be real careful about telling future presidents how to organize. You know, there was an idea, for example, a couple years ago, the National Security Advisor should be a confirmable official and should be accountable to the Congress. Worst idea ever. And also completely impractical. Could you imagine poor Susan Rice being called up on the Hill every third day to say, what did you say to the president yesterday? That would be terrible. So I found you the problem, but I don't know what the solution is. And I hope you all work on it.
This kind of relates to the last question, but Iraq and Afghanistan, this isn't the last time we're going to be, conducting an insurgency or counterinsurgency operation or reconstruction mission. And in fact, since Iraq and Afghanistan, we've had Libya, Syria, Yemen. And it doesn't seem that we, even over the 14 years, have really institutionalized or internalized much of the lessons that have been learned. And part of it, at least to me, seems to be a lack of strategy. The House or the Senate Armed Services Committee had a U.S. Middle East defense strategy hearing, and Secretary Carter and Chairman Dunford weren't able to articulate what the U.S. strategy is for the Middle East. And so without a strategy, you can have the best intentions and policies, but you're not going to institutionalize, you're not going to internalize, and it's just going to be an ad hoc response. My hair's on fire today, how do I put out this one fire? So I'm curious what your thoughts are on how people argue there hasn't been a grand strategist since Kissinger. How do you kind of, given the ad hoc nature of the NSC, it changes from president to president, how do you establish a grand strategy?
Very, very tough. There was an article in the Foreign Affairs one issue back that argued against strategy and in favor of pragmatism. And it was a very frustrating article. I don't think there's anything more pragmatic than a good strategy. And the problem today, I think, is not that we don't have strategy. We have a strategy. It's just not getting it done. And, we won't answer in public some pretty tough questions. For example, I'll pose one question to the Committee of the Whole. Iraq, Syria, ISIS. Is ISIS a threat to U.S. vital interests or not? Or is it a threat to our friends in the region, which is, I think, where a lot of people are at over in the White House. But part of the problem that this administration has is a scarcity of strategy and abundance of rhetoric. I've just never, ever seen any president of late who will never miss an opportunity to overstate the case. We're going to destroy and defeat. We're gonna take him out. And here's a red line. Assad must go. You also mentioned the issue of post-conflict situations. That's a tough issue. We've been down the road. In Afghanistan, we had a light footprint, didn't work. In Iraq, we had a heavier footprint, didn't work. In Libya, we had no footprint, and that didn't work. That didn't work probably worse than the others didn't work. It's a tough situation. The smart people say, well, it's not the size of your footprint. It's the, again, your point. It's the strategy. How are you going to do this? How are you going to get it done? And very, very sad. Libya was a great triumph for about 3 weeks. And, someone confronted me the other day and said, imagine another world. Imagine a world where Libya was ruled by Gaddafi, Syria was ruled completely by Assad and his army, and Iraq was ruled by Saddam Hussein or by now probably one of his sons. Would that be a better world? And, you know, my answer professorially was on the one hand, on the other hand, on the third hand. You know, I'm not so sure that wasn't a better world for us.
Just as a follow-up to your last point, Tom Brooks has often said that the U.S. argues that it wants to do stability operations, right? Or that's, we're in the business of stability operations. But in fact, to your last point, if we were really interested in stability operations, would we have overthrown Gaddafi or, you know, Hussein, or now trying to ultimately overthrow Assad? Now, when you ask the U.S. military, you know, well, if you're doing stability operations, you really are in the business of doing, you know.
Yeah, very, very difficult. Very, very difficult situation. Of course, what I see when I go on to these things is, we had a choice with Saddam. We chose after 10 years of to-ing and fro-ing with him. I mean, in 2002, I read this the other day, and the fact was so shocking, I went back and I looked it up, and it's true. Saddam Hussein attacked U.S. aircraft in 2002 500 times. We responded 90 times. The Air Force was at war from 91 to 2003 over the skies of Iraq. So, you know, we sort of forget that environment, and which is not to make an excuse for blundering into that particular situation. And one of the things that's interesting, I fought very hard to separate Iraq and Afghanistan in our book. I lost. And I was so happy to find out that I was right to have lost. Because when you treat Iraq and Afghanistan in the same chapter, you begin to see, oh my God, what's happening in Afghanistan is really a subfunction of what's happening in Iraq. And all of the so-called mistakes in Afghanistan came from the fact that, as Admiral Mullen said, in Iraq we did what we had to do, and in Afghanistan we did what we could with what was left over. Sort of an interesting point, too, for people who do strategy work on the whole issue of, they do strategy work on the issue of, you know, how many major contingencies should you prepare for? You know, it's almost, you know, the armed forces can handle more than one contingency. I'm not so sure about the people that work in the White House. You know, something to think about. Walt, sir.
Talk about intelligence. You mentioned earlier that George Tenet was the only person to get Al-Qaeda.
Mm-hmm.
But when we went into the war in Iraq, in retrospect, it looks like either the intelligence was bad or the American people were lied to.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like you to comment a little bit about why George Tenet got the medal of whatever he got when our intelligence was one of the major failures in going into Iraq.
Yeah, there's a lot of people who had something to say about that, and you know, he was someone who was beloved in two different administrations, and frankly, and this is 2020 hindsight right now, and we also have to know in Washington there's one truism that always holds. There are only two kinds of events, and that's a policy success or an intelligence failure. So the people in the intelligence world, I have great sympathy for them because no matter what happens, they get blamed for it. If we're around for the second coming, the last thing that happens before the end of the world will be that the director of the CIA gets fired for not predicting the second coming and following all the warning signs in the back of the Bible. But I'm joking. But not so much. They would expect them to do that. It's hard to explain. Tenet also was sort of the partner of Richard Clarke, and the two of them together were not enough to convince the administration. I also think, and I'm guessing that Tenet wanted to keep his job in the Bush administration, and that he knew that people were not particularly interested in Al-Qaeda stories, and he didn't push it as hard as he might have. And if he thought he was going to leave at the end of the first year, maybe he would have been banging that gong a little harder. I just don't know. One thing that I've been sort of obsessed with because I was there part of it, and Stan McChrystal said this. We did not put it in our book, by the way, but Stan McChrystal said this. He said, I don't believe in intelligence failure. He said, everybody read the intelligence, and they saw what they wanted to see. There certainly is something to that. And if you were of the opinion that we were going to remake the Middle East by invading Iraq, every time somebody talked about Iraqi weapons of mass destruction, you were taking notes. And even the director of the CIA, if the CIA had gone to the president, and actually at one point, the president said to George Tenet, is that all you got?
Yeah.
Is that all you got? And then later Tenet said, this is a slam dunk, not to worry. And actually, this was a Swiss cheese with more holes in it than the European Union allows. And we should have basically, and there are things you can do. You can develop the situation. I remember this happened like days before the war started. I finally got a briefing on how they were going to go after the sites, and I saw the list. There was 250 suspect sites. And I said, this is a simple Leavenworth problem. You go start with the definites, you go to the probables, you go to the possibles, and then you have the invading force sweep up all the other ones that are in their path. And the guy said, he was showing me the briefing book, he said, there's only one problem with that. He said, there are no definites. And he said, of these 200 right here, he said, I couldn't begin to rank order them the way you just said. And I said to him, well, why not? We were getting run up for this, why weren't we sending Green Beret A teams and SEALs and everybody in there just to sit there on the ground with big binoculars and see what's going on at this site right here? Let's take some soil samples. Let's take some air samples. Let's maybe even with CIA hire some people to get on a truck to go in to deliver fruit to the commander of the ammo dump, And he could have a sensor on him or something. None of that was done. I don't know why none of that was done. Nora.
In your chapter, you talk about shifting strategic objectives and faulty assumptions. Who bears a burden of responsibility to lock down the objectives and to validate the assumptions?
Well, ultimately, the president does, but it was done all along. And, I said in my chapter, there were three key assumptions. And everything was sort of molded around these three key assumptions. And the first was that the war would be very hard and probably end up with the use of weapons of mass destruction. And Nora, you were there. You were probably in your chemical suit when you crossed the line of departure. And secondly, the peace would be easy. Why would the peace be easy? Because we were going to turn it over to the Iraqis real quick, and we were going to get down to 30,000 people from almost 150,000 by September. And that's what the CENTCOM staff was working on while Baghdad was burning. They were working on the schedules for getting the troops out on time. And the third thing was that, you know, reconstruction would probably be necessary because there was a war there after all. And it would be paid for by the Iraqis, who after all were very wealthy because of their oil money. And, you know, there was one particular guy, I can't remember his name, he suggested that the war in Iraq was going to cost the United States $5 billion. He got eased out of office. He was a White House guy. And he got eased out of office before the war began because no one wanted anyone to contemplate that this could, you know, the taxpayers would be paying to fix roads or electricity or whatever. And this guy was lower than that. He wasn't a cabinet rank guy, but he was a name. He was a name. And he was, he was hushed down. And, you know, and General Shinseki. General Shinseki. You know, he was forced by Senator Levin to, say, how many people are going to be there in the occupation force? And he said, well, based upon what I know from Bosnia, you know, several hundred thousand. Which, by the way, that number was, those numbers were in the war plan as a possibility, you know, worst case situation. But nobody, it wasn't a real vital plan. I got time for one more question before, you know, the landlord throws us out. Sir, in the front, sir.
Sir, Major Reynolds, a bit from the Chief Station. So looking at these two wars on the world stage, there's a lot of actors watching the United States go in there, and with its conventional military dominance, you know, topple a government really fast. So what's happened is now there's increasing incidence of non-state actors and actors operating just below the threshold of any kind of military action or any kind of response, and they know there's an unwillingness to do anything. So what SOCOM calls the growing gray zone, and Rupert Smith called the military era war amongst the people. So right now, as we plan our capabilities, the Army's already cutting, you know, we're going to cut those that can contend in this arena, war amongst the people, the civil affairs, brigades, intelligence. Do you think, in your opinion, we can balance under this declining budget and these force cuts to strike the right balance and maintain the proper capabilities, you know, preserve the lethality?
It's very hard, you know. If you're the chairman of the Joint Chiefs and if you're a member of the Joint Chiefs and you work for the Army Chief, you've got to create a balanced force that's capable across the spectrum of conflict, ready to fight the Chinese one day, North Koreans the next day, deal with Iran, you know, breaking, you know, out of the treaty regime, and continuing to fight. And so, sadly now, there is a growing notion among a lot of people, not a lot, but some influential people, that when the Pentagon said we're not going to build forces for large-scale counterinsurgency and stability operations, that means those things are no longer important. By the way, we asked that directly to General Dempsey, and he said, absolutely not. He said, all of the chiefs are obsessed with not forgetting the lessons we learned in Iraq and Afghanistan. And, you know, I wanted to say, hey, look around, you know? And even in the State Department. State Department, you know, they went up to the Congress and they said, we want a civilian response corps. And, you know, that got voted down. And then ultimately, the State Department just shut that whole effort down. There's a group of retired insurgents who are still trying to get the civilian response corps, which is an important thing to have. So the next time we have a Jerry Bremer, he'll be able to call on the right people to do the right things. We're not there. I see Katie, she's got the hook in her hand.
Dr. Phillips, thank you so much for coming here today and
speaking to our community here.
Okay.